So following this talk, there will be an opportunity to ask Dr. Shaw questions. So please submit your questions throughout the talk using the chat function. And I will then collect them at the end and put them to Dr. Shaw, or I will ask you to unmute if you prefer to do it yourself. And hold on a second, sorry. Now I'm especially delighted to introduce to you our speaker today and her nematodes. So Dr. Leticia Shaw is a molecular biologist in the Casanueva Laboratory at the Abraham Institute, and she's also an active member of the postdoctoral community of our college. So Dr. Shaw's work focuses on understanding inter-individual variability in a stress response gene expression and its consequences on physiology. And C. elegans is a great model to address this question, as these nematodes are genetically identical and the transparency allows the use of fluorescent gene expression reporters in different tissues. So over to you, Dr. Shaw.
Right, thank you so much, Christina, and hi everyone. I'm sure you get some French for my accent. So let me try to share my screen. Okay, all right. So today I'm going to try to take you into a journey into the worms, and especially a little microscopic worms called C. elegans. And I'm going to try to show you how I think they are a great, great model, and especially at the Babram Institute. So not sure you've heard of us because we are in Cambridge, but a bit outside, south, few kilometers south of Addenbrooke, and we study aging. And they are a very great model for that. I hope I'll convince you today. And I'm gonna talk a little bit of heat and smart worms also. And yes, I'm in the Casanueva lab at the Babram Institute. I've been there for 6 years now. And as I was mentioning, I would like to introduce you to C. elegans, to show you how they are cool. But in the second part, I would like also to show you how they are can be smart, can learn things. And then in the third part, I would like to show you what I actually did a bit during my postdoc and where we are now with, we found that they have a neuronal thermostat. And so, as you can see here, you know, this is depicting a bit all the model organisms that exist, you know, and I'm kind of like, you know, this scientist, my favorite is obviously C. elegans, these little worms, and like a favorite of her, you can recognize Drosophila, zebrafish, yeast, and I really think it's the best, and I hope I'll convince you. Friedrich Nietzsche, he said, "You have made your way from worm to human, but much in you is still worm." And I think it kind of holds true. So let's see why. So this is a beast. This is C. elegans, you know, it's, this is it, you know, it's very tiny, but of course its center stage is quite big. And I have to say, so it's kind of cool to be in Cambridge because actually so the research on C. elegans started in 1963 in Cambridge, you know. There was Sidney Brenner who decided that it was going to be a very interesting model organism. He got a Nobel Prize for his discovery, and he even said at the reception when he got the Nobel Prize, "C. elegans is nature's gift to science." And there was not only one Nobel Prize, but actually three that were associated with C. elegans. Like to go a bit more into details, you know, the first one in 2002, it was Sidney Brenner, you know, the C. elegans research dad actually, and Joel Selston also, who was also here in Cambridge, the director of the Sanger Institute. And then the three of them with Bob Horvist, they made a major discovery that during development, you know, you have some cells that kill themselves. It's called apoptosis, and they did that with the worms. Like, you know, so you can find fundamental things that are conserved. Then in 2006, a major one also, to Andrew Fire and Craig Mello for the discovery of RNA interference, a way of small RNAs to interfere, to silence the expression of genes. And in 2008, there was also another one in chemistry system to Martin Chalfie for the use of green fluorescent protein in animals. And in C. elegans, it's perfect because they are transparent. So I'm going to show you later some images with GFP. So, but first, I show you the worm very big, but in reality, you know, they are very, very tiny. Like you know, this is kind of, you would barely not see anything. That's kind of what makes them cute also, I have to say. But so you need a microscope, obviously, because they are 1 millimeter long and the diameter of a hair. So let me tell you that when you have to inject DNA in the gonad, it's like really surgery in a microscopic worm. It can be very challenging. So where do you find C. elegans in the wild? Actually, they are everywhere. But obviously, they are so tiny that we don't realize, we don't see them. But most likely, you will find them in rotten fruits or rotten stems. That's where they like to be, because what they eat is, and they eat bacteria that you find in rotten fruits. So it's nice, they are non-parasitic, and then they like to eat those bacteria. And actually, to find them, because there are research, C. elegans researchers who collect strains in the wild and study genetic differences. We have isolates from all over the world, and it's a very interesting project. But what you would do, and we tried actually with the school here in Colchester, like in order to collect C. elegans from the wild, this is what you do. You take little bits of rotten elements that you find in nature. Rotten apples are very good for that. So you put them on a petri dish. And here in the middle, this kind of circle, this is the bacteria, say food, that we use in the lab, that it's transparent. And you can see after a while, they are going to crawl from the rotten samples to the bacteria. And the bacteria is kind of transparent, so it's very easy for us to see it. So that's how we collect them. And sometimes I've been on vacation, you know, like with little plastic bags, hoping to find, like, you know, to collect some samples and maybe to find a new isolate, but so far, no. But I'm still hoping for Cambridge, because I don't think there is an official isolate for Cambridge. So C. elegans versus humans. If I would ask you who has the most genes, I'm sure you would be very tempted probably to say humans. But when we look at the numbers, the truth is humans have about 20 to 25,000 genes. And the worms, pretty much the same, actually, which makes it a bit, you know, it makes us a bit humble that we function with kind of like the same number of genes than just these little microscopic worms. But there is still one big difference, because the genome of the worm is very compact. So our genome is much bigger. So we have genes, but we have also a lot of other stuff. So C. elegans genome, it's said to be very compact. And that's why it was very useful. It was the first organism that was sequenced. And it was very useful because it's so compact, you know. So, at that time, the technology that was developed to sequence it really helped to do later the human genome, which obviously it's much bigger. And then among those 20-ish thousand genes, that's where I think Friedrich Nietzsche is right, because about half of them are conserved. And so it means that what you are, a gene you are, if you want to study a gene in humans, you know, you can look for the orthologs, the conserved genes in worms, and look at what it does. And I think I've seen even a recent paper when you look at conservation of protein sequence, I think people think it's even more than half. So it's a little worm, doesn't look like us, but actually you can learn a lot from it. It's also very easy to grow in the lab. There were the wild type worms that we have in the lab. It grows at at room temperatures and very fast. You know, you go from an embryo into an adult worm in about 3 days. So it's very fast, and in total, they live about 3 weeks. And there is also one cool thing, because a lot of what we do is making transgenic worms, like GMO strain of what we are interested in studying. But then when you have to, you obviously have to keep every strain. And what is very cool, we can cryogenize them, and we have a library of worm strains. And for instance, people who study Drosophila, they cannot do that. So it means that every Friday, just before the weekend, someone has to maintain all the Drosophila strains. And we are lucky, we don't need that. You know, you go back years later, take a little bit of the frozen vial with the worms, and they resuscitate. It's a small larvae, the first stage larvae called L1, actually, who survive cryogenization. So another very interesting thing that was completely mapped by John Sulston, and that makes it a very good model for the study of development, is unlike us, they have a very fixed number of cells. You know, we all have different number of cells. For them, it's exactly 959, and it's all mapped. And this is what you see here on this slide. You know, you start from the zygotes, and then this is all like the division that happens until you finish with the cells that constitute every of these tissues. So it's very interesting, obviously, for development. And I think that's how they actually found out that some cells were missing or had disappeared during development, which was apoptosis. So another very cool thing also, which is like a bit the point, you know, also why we use it as a model for aging, is because it's so much easier to measure the lifespan of a worm, which is about 3 weeks, and for instance mice, where it's 2 years, or other model organism. And and here I want to show you one mutant, DAF2 mutant, who is amazing. It lives very much longer. And this was discovered by Cynthia Kenyon in California. I think now she works for Calico company from Google, who specially works on aging. And she was the first to identify that mutant. It has where the DAF2 gene is non-functional. And it's amazing. They live like really like you see them side by side. They live forever. And that's how also it was found that we know from this work that some genetic pathways are very important for aging. And so DAF2, this is the name of the worm gene, but what it is in humans, it's an insulin receptor. And it's kind of amazing too, because obviously we don't study mutants in humans, we would never do that, but people have seen that people who tend to live very long, more than 90 years old, often have some polymorphism in the same gene, and in the way that it's going to work a bit less. So this is a pathway that is conserved also in, like, from worms to humans. So it was an amazing discovery. And my favorite also is the fact, as I mentioned, that they are transparent. And so this is Martin Chalfie, you know, who got the Nobel Prize. And you can, a lot of what we do is just engineering whatever we want to study and tag it with a green fluorescent protein. And here, for instance, in these beautiful worms, you see all the neurons that are tagged in green. And those one I kind of like too. They are just a subtype of neurons, GABA neurons. So yeah, I hope that kind of showed you how it can be a very interesting model. And now I'm gonna show you the worm, the mind of a worm. This is a bit like, you know, for cell development, everything is mapped. Well, for the nervous system, it's a bit the same. And you would think, you know, that like a little worm like this, you know, doesn't think much. But actually, I told you it has 959 cells, and a third of it, 302, are neurons. So it doesn't seem much, 302, but it's still a third of them. And what is, so obviously it's a very simple nervous system. But what is cool about it is also all mapped. We know every chemical synapse, how they connect to each other. It all has been mapped. So what can you do with 302 neurons? So in the environment of the worms, you know, obviously it's nothing compared like the complexity of our brain, but still we are able to have different classes of neurons, basically sensory neurons who kind of detect what information the worms has to detect, and that is very important for it to survive. Then we have also internal neurons and motor neurons that, you know, allow the worms to move. And among the things that are very important for the worms to know is like salt concentration, temperature, pheromones, odors, and they adapt, you know, by moving, by habituating. They have a lot of behaviors also. And to show you how they can be smart, I'm taking as an example here a behavior that we call thermotaxis. So here, basically, you have worms that you have read on a gradient of various temperatures from 17 to 23. So worms have been previously cultivated at 23 degrees. So it means that for them, they know at 23 degrees, they had food. And so when you put them on this temperature gradient, there is no food, but they will go and migrate exactly to find themselves at 23 degrees. That associative learning, they know exactly, they have remember that this is a good temperature for food. And it works also with salt concentration. For instance, if you cultivate the worms here in the white in low salt concentration, so for them it's kind of very important salt concentration, because if it's too much, because they experience osmosis, you know, they are going to be shrinked. So for a worm it's very important to be at the right it's osmosis is very important. And so what happens here also, so it's always all associated with food. If they are cultivated with low salt concentration, they will go back to it when they have the choice of different concentration. And if you do the opposite, if they are exposed with food onto high salt concentration, they will still go back to it. And this is the opposite if you starve them. If you give them no food and they were on low salt concentration, then they will want to do the opposite. Say, no, that's not good. I'm going to try the other concentration, and vice versa. If they are on high salt, they will try to go to low salt. So all of that is associative learning. And this type of behavior is called chemotaxis behavior. So how can that be? One more thing is true that I wanted to tell you about the way they learn also, which I found very cool, is that they can teach their progeny. So here you have, OP50 is the name of the bacteria that we feed them with, and that's the standard food that they have in the lab. But sometimes we give them, we are not nice, we give them a pathogenic bacteria. They only have this on the plate, so they kind of eat it, but it kind of kills them also in the meantime, so it's not great. So usually they go, they taste it, they realize it's not great, and they avoid it. But then what is cool is in their progeny, here their progeny hasn't been exposed to the green bad bacteria, but what was found is actually the progeny of the worms that were exposed to pathogenic bacteria and learned how to avoid it. Their progeny also did the same. And then, so they were able to transmit that information, the parents, to the progeny. And people know, I think, that it comes from small RNAs. So that's all interesting ways that the worm learned. But how can it be useful for us? And here I want to show you an example of a potential things that can be applied for human health, and how the worms also could be useful for that. And this comes from the work of some of my colleagues previously, where I did my PhD at Northwestern University, who have developed this assay. And I'm going to talk a little bit about tuberculosis. So tuberculosis is like a major infectious disease. In 2019, there was like 10 million cases, and it led to 1.4 million deaths just in that 1 year. Just to compare to COVID right now, I think we are like 3.9 million deaths with COVID, just to give a range. But and also a lot of the problem with tuberculosis is that like a third of the world population has latent tuberculosis, like say it's a pathogenic bacteria in your lung, and they have it and they are fine. But about 10% of those will risk to develop the disease and falling ill. And the good part about it is that it's preventable and it's curable. There is like an antibiotics treatment that you take for quite a long time, for 6 to 9 months. And so it's good to know if you have it, because then it's possible to prevent it, obviously. And also one thing that is kind of important to take into account is like the prevalence of the disease is not in the world everywhere, but it mostly affects population here in the south of Africa, in low and middle income countries. So it would be very important to have a way to be able to know if you have the disease, but it's, which kind of would work also in those countries. Sorry, I passed one slide. So where you know that you have tuberculosis, and that's where the worms come handy, is because you have in your breath, when you breathe, you have like four compounds, four chemical compounds that we call volatile organic compounds that are typical of tuberculosis. So the work of my colleague was to try to do what they call a chemotaxis assay, to try to see if the worms would be able to detect those compounds, because before that, people have tried successfully, actually with bees and mice, they can detect those compounds, but it's not very convenient as an assay, because it means that each time you want to detect it in one person, you need one mice, so it wouldn't work very easily, and also, or one bee. So what they did is they tested if the worms were able to detect the volatile organic compounds from typical of tuberculosis, and they do what is called the chemotaxis assay. So basically you have worms in the center of the plate and you have four spots. Two of them, A and C, they are the control. And B and D are the test, whatever you want to see if the worms is able to detect or not. And so this is how it goes at the beginning of the experiment. And for instance here, this is an example, a control example where nothing happens. So in B and D, you have put ethanol and there is no reaction, because at the end of the assay, you look in which quadrant the worms are. And from this, from where they are, you determine a chemotaxis index that tells you if it's positive, they are attracted to whatever you are testing, and if it's negative, it's the opposite. And for instance, here, with octanol, there were waypulse. As you can see, octanol was here in B and D, and they clearly went to the other side. And the opposite now, isoamyl alcohol, they are attracted to it. As you can see, they are at the end of the experiment, they are a lot in B and D. So what happens with those tuberculosis volatile compounds? So it was quite nice, because actually they were able to detect and to have like, so they are all here, and you can see for one of them they are attracted, for the three of them they are repulsed, but it looks like the worms can smell that. And the nice thing about it is also because it's difficult to use animals for this kind of assay, but there is a cool thing about the worms that I haven't mentioned before, is that when they don't have food, or like it's too hot, or there is a problem with the environment, the worms stop developing because they cannot. The conditions are not good enough, and that way they enter an alternative stage, which is called dour, and they can stay like this for months. And in that stage, you know, obviously their metabolism slow down, but they can survive for months, and they don't need food, and they still move. And the cool thing about the work of that team at Northwestern is they found that what they were tested, would it be possible to have those little dour larvae smelling the tuberculosis compound, and they do actually, it was done with Dauer. So obviously, yes, there would be much more work to kind of make it a real test, you know, but I just wanted to show you a potential application for it. But the idea to have it as a test would be that, you know, something like this, you have little Dauer worms for months, you know, on a device, the person would breathe. And then depending on where they go, you could determine if if those compounds are in the breath or not. And that would be also a very cheap test, which would be very interesting also to develop in low and middle income countries. So yes, that was all for C. elegans is smart, and I hope I showed you how they can learn things and also they can potentially be useful for us humans. And in the last part, I just wanted to talk a little bit of actually my work, what we did in our lab and what we found. And it's also related to neurons also and how we think they are using their neurons as a thermostat. Because as I was mentioning, the worms, they grow at room temperatures, but they are not like us who can regulate their own temperatures. So for them, they are okay between 15 degrees to 25 degrees. That's fine. But then when you go above 25 degrees, that's where comes heat stress. And that's very problematic for the worms. Not only for the worms, it would be for any living organism actually, but that's for them, it's the temperature that is the threshold, because what happens if they are exposed too long at that temperature? So it denatures the structure of proteins, and then it can cause protein aggregation. And this is so problematic for the cells. So they need to clear that, and to counteract the effect of heat stress. So what the worms do, but not only the worms, like every living organism, you know, even plants, bacteria, everyone to survive have a sort of a what we call a heat shock response. And us too, obviously, we could not survive without that. And what it does, so obviously it's a very important response. As soon as it senses that there is a little bit too much heat and it's gonna affect the structure of proteins, we have this protein here, which is called heat shock factor 1. It's a transcription factor. So what it does, it gets activated and it goes into the nucleus where it orders the cell to produce a lot of heat shock proteins. And those heat shock proteins, we also call them molecular chaperones. And their job is not at very high level in normal condition, but when HSF1, heat shock factor 1 is activated, and the cell has a massive response. They produce a lot of chaperones, and the job of those chaperones is to refold proteins, and if it's not possible, then they will degrade them, and that's how cell can survive. So that's a very important response. But I've always been, I studied also HSF1 during my PhD, and I've always been intrigued by what it does when it's not under stress, because it's been characterized by this actually. So how it's kind of funny how it was found, because it's an Italian biologist, his name was Ritosa, and he was looking at big giant chromosomes of Drosophila, and he was seeing that if he was hitting them, suddenly he would see like puff happening around the chromosome, and that was actually the production of a lot of heat shock proteins. So he saw it actually in vivo at the beginning. But what I was going to say is actually we know also, it's very well established that heat shock factor 1 has a very important role in non-stress at like just between 15 and 25 degrees. And how we know that, and that's related to aging, is because the worms that are deprived of HSF1, of heat shock factor 1, they are mutants for it in green, they live much shorter. And this is the opposite for the worms which have more of heat shock factor 1. So it's clearly very important for aging. And HSF1 is such an important protein that it's expressed everywhere in all the tissues of the worms, but there is one tissue that is known to be particularly important for that effect, which is neurons. And so what we did in the lab, we tried to characterize a little bit more what was going on with worms that have more Hitchcock factor 1 in neurons. And here I'm going to talk a lot about those worms. So I call them neuro-HSF1, and it means that they have more Hitchcock factor 1 in neurons. They are more prepared to deal with stress in neurons only. And as I was telling you, so worms that have more Hitchcock factor 1, but in that case in neurons, as you can see, they are in red and they live much longer at 25 degrees. But there is something a little bit curious about it, because if you do the same experiment at a colder temperature, it's pretty much the same as the control. So that effect happens only at warmer temperatures. And just for the little story, this experiment I did during the beginning of lockdown, that one, like especially, which is a little bit longer, I have to say, because when you grow the worms at a colder temperature, they tend to live a little bit longer. And I was exactly here, and I had spent hours passing my worms, and lockdown happened. And I'm glad I was able to take the microscope and the worms that was here at home. That was my home lab, and I was able to finish that one, like without having a small incubator that was at 15 degrees. So it's what is intriguing is like why the effect on lifespan is not the same depending on this range of temperatures. And what we were thinking is maybe neuro-HSF1 worms, they are more adapted to warmer temperatures. So what could be that type of adaptation? And something that is very important at any temperature and to adapt at small changes in temperature is how the worms are able to adjust a membrane viscosity, which obviously is very important because this is the membrane of all our cells. And here, as you can see, membranes are bilayers of lipids. And it's called the homeoviscous adaptation theory, but basically at colder temperature, to maintain proper viscosity of the membrane, you need to incorporate a little bit more unsaturated fatty acid. So all the fatty acids are also here. And the unsaturated fatty acids, they are called like this because they have a double bond here, a carbon double bond. This double bond creates an angle, and that's why you know they are here. And that angle is able to create more space in between the lipid of the membrane. And so if you didn't have this, what would happen at cold temperature would be that, like pretty much like when you put olive oil in the fridge, you know, it becomes a bit solid. So that's the way that the cells have evolved to deal with changes in temperature, especially in the worms that cannot regulate their own temperature. It's very important. And the way that is known in the worms that this happens at colder temperature is thanks to an enzyme which is called steroyl CoA desaturase, which is two actually in the worms. We call them FAT6 and FAT7, but their job is to unsaturate fatty acid. So obviously very important at colder temperature, but not so much at warmer temperature. This is the opposite, because at warmer temperatures, you want to just have saturated fatty acid to have more viscous membrane. And it's also very well known in the worms that the level of that enzyme that adjusts all of this, they are much lower at warmer temperatures. So how does it relate to our neuro-HSF1 worms? Well, we were wondering if our neuro-HSF1 worms could be more adapted because maybe they had their membrane more adapted to warmer temperatures. So what we did, and we have a great facility for this at Babram, we did phospholipidomics analysis where we look at all the lipids, but only from the membranes. And this is a control that we did. So here I'm just showing to you one example with one lipid, phosphatidylethanolamine 38. And this is a control that we did. So we have a mutant that doesn't have the FAT6, FAT7 enzyme necessary at colder temperatures. And here what you see on that graph is all the different species of P38 with all the number of double bonds that is exactly counted. So if they have more double bonds, obviously it's more unsaturated. If they have less, it's more saturated. And as you would expect, in that mutant that is not able to incorporate unsaturated fatty acid at cold temperature, we see a shift toward more saturation. And so now, when we did it with our neuro HSF1 worms, it was quite nice because, yes, we kind of saw the same shift also. As you see in red, worms overexpressing heat shock factor 1s in neurons have more saturated membranes like this. So indeed, even though our worms are raised at 20 degrees, which is like the standard temperature in the lab, you know, here in Cambridge, where it's usually not that hot, they sort of think a little bit that they are in Hawaii and they are prepared for being in Hawaii. So I'm just not gonna tell you all the details, you know, that would be way too much, but just to summarize a little bit what we have found. So we have found that just having more of heat shock factor 1 in neurons is able to change the membranes of the worms. And then so what we actually have found doing more experiments is it completely changed the fat metabolism, which in the worms happen in the intestine. It's not like us where we have intestine and tissues where the fat is stored. In the worms, it all happens within the intestine. And we found actually that happens by through two different pathways. One of them was inactivated, this enzyme that I was telling you about that is able to unsaturate fatty acid. And another way where it was activated, lipase gene that break down the fat. And just, you know, like just to summarize, I won't go into details, but as I was telling you, this, because it changed the fat program in the intestine, what is cool here, it's able to adjust membrane fluidity across tissues and to promote heat adaptation. And that's the thing that is new here, because homeoviscous adaptation, it has been found in bacteria, you know, it's known for a long time. But then what we found here, what is new, is that actually there is an input of neurons on that. And obviously, you know, I was telling you, we know everything about the neurons in the worms. There are 302. So we try to look, you know, if there was a particular set of neurons that was important for this. And this is what we found, that we don't understand completely yet the full picture because it's kind of complex. But what we know is that there is a set of 12 sensory neurons that are all here, that are in the head of the animals, and they are expressing two subunits, TAX2 and TAX4, which are a receptor which is in only that set of neurons, and that is necessary for the proper function of those neurons. And those neurons are important for that effect to happen. So that's what we know so far, and it's kind of interesting, but you could tell me, you know, you kind of are studying, you know, a weird worm, you know, worms that overexpress heat shock factor 1 in neurons. They are like a little bit of a monster. How does, you know, how is it important, or how does it reflect on just normal worm living in the wild? And that's where we thought actually maybe the fact that those worms have clearly more HSF1 activation in neurons, and they are more prepared for the worms. So maybe actually we thought of it, or maybe it could be a thermostat that maybe maybe neurons would be the more a tissue very sensitive to stress, proteotoxic stress, the stress that affects the structure of proteins. And the more you feel like you have stressed neurons, then it would act as a thermostat to adjust, you know, to turn the fat program in the intestine and to adjust membrane viscosity. And so if it was true, then we would expect that in just wild-type worms, not neuro-HSF1 worms, then we would be able to detect some sign of stress in neurons. And then that if we turn a bit the temperature, then it would be correlated also that it would increase with temperatures. And luckily, because worms are great, we have all sorts of reporters, we have a very good reporter for that. This is a fluorescent reporter. It's a reporter from, it gets activated. It's a target of heat shock factor one. So it gets activated if HSF1 is activated. And what you can see here, it's a chaperone. This is a chaperone reporter. If you don't heat shock the worms, just under normal conditions, we can see that there is some green signal in the head, which shows that this reporter is activated. And if we look bigger, we can see that those actually are neurons. We see the axons here. And so we try to change temperature. And actually, it's true that if you see much less activation at 15 degrees and a little bit more, you know, if more neurons turn green and more neurons seem to be stressed if you turn on the temperature. So in a wild type worm, it seems to be very sensitive to temperatures. So that's kind of what we have found so far, that in an ectotherm worm, an organism that is not able to regulate its own temperature, somehow having more HSF1 activation in neurons, but we think this is generally more the case for neuronal stress, this is able to reprogram fat metabolism in the intestine and adjust membrane fluidity across tissues and in order to promote heat adaptation. And in a way, you know, if you look at us, you know, endotherm, it's not that, it's true that from, it's not that maybe that different, because also in endotherm, we have the hypothalamus that is able to integrate body temperature variation and to generate body adjustments. And what we see also with the worms is thanks to their neuronal stress and their neuronal thermostat, it seems like there is also an input on the nervous system to kind of adjust the whole system. So that's it. I think I've told you everything. And then this is just to thank the amazing people, all my lab and a lot of people and students and research assistants have worked on this project with me. And it was great. We had great facilities at Babram. And just, you know, just because this is actually, like, in August, I'll move on and, you know, I'm going to do something completely different. So I've been studying worms for 12 years now, you know, PhD plus postdoc, and I had, you know, the worm costume. This is from one of the international C. elegans conference in Los Angeles, where worm people are very creative, worm researchers, and someone had made worm costume out of a sleeping bag, which I thought was super cool. And then I'm gonna switch that soon. You know, I'm gonna do something a bit different, you know, and I'm gonna move to Ireland in August and do a postdoc to study gene dosage sensitivity in yeast. And I just wanted to say that it has been great to be part of the college for those 3 years, and I for sure will miss you. It was a big highlight of the life here in Cambridge. And of course, if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them. Hopefully, I didn't talk too much. Also, I did talk a lot. And I should probably stop sharing.
Thanks, Leticia. That was great. Well, you know, I love this topic.
And I love
how you present. So it's been amazing. And of course, I hope you'll be joining our events in the next academic year. And yes, and you let us know how everything goes in the new lab.
And of course, yeah.
We wish you a very smooth transition.
Thank you. And I'm happy to, you know, especially if there are events online, it's easier also from the other island.
Exactly. And we want to know what you're going to be doing next and how you'll be, not worms, but...
No, I know, quite different, but...
maybe you can do some things at home after, you know, worms from... apples or rotten food.
Yes, and I have the feeling anyway, at some point I will go back to worms. I just want to explore something a little bit different.
Exactly. So, so I think we are having some questions. First thing, let me, so I'm not sure, Teresa, if you want to unmute and ask yourself the question, otherwise I'll go for it. So Teresa was asking, how do C. elegans use associated learning in nature, and why have they evolved to have associated learning? Yeah, I think that's quite interesting, the associated learning.
That's a very good question. You know, like obviously we study it in the lab. So I mean, what I can tell you is that it's very important for the worms because also, unfortunately, most of the time in the wild, you know, like, you know, in the lab, we have some, you know, in the nice plate and they're in the middle, in the food. But in the wild, most of the time, you find them in dour stage, which means, you know, they have no food anymore. It's too hot. Or that's mostly how we find them. And then we, in the lab, they resume development on plates. But then I guess for them, it's very important to show you how for them, it's a way to know that food is here, if like it's associated for that concentration, it's a way to memorize where it's more likely to find food, and obviously to very important to not be in that worst stage, you know, to find food. So I think that's why they evolved that way. But it's who all our assays are done in the lab, very controlled. You know, it's not exactly the wild conditions. I don't know if I completely answered the question, but I mean, wild worms are fascinating, you know, fascinating, obviously, all what we do is in the lab.
Yeah, I think we've talked about this in the past, right? How difficult it is, I guess, just like trying to give an explanation of why the evolution had to take them to do all these complex connections and managing to have that adaptation. So yeah. Well, we'll see in the future, I guess, more work also on that front.
What I can say maybe also on that, you know, is because especially in, on the last part I didn't mention, but you know, this idea of having a neuronal thermostat and some neurons that are stressed, actually we know it's super variable, you know, in even at a given temperature of like, let's say 20 degrees, you would have some worms who would have a lot of green neurons, some less. And we think also variability is maybe an evolutive tool here. Like it may be interesting because obviously being a worm, you know, your environment is always changing. So that's why they really have to adapt. And maybe at the population level, the fact that you have worms that are prepared for the worms that are prepared for cold, you know, it means that at the population level, it's interesting because the population is prepared for anything. Basically, if it becomes very hot, the stressed worms are gonna survive. But there is also not a problem, but a trade-off is they will have less progeny. And then if it's the opposite, you know, if it's colder, like the other one are gonna do better. So it's all about trade-off. It's true. And so I think what is cool is also variability is actually a good thing for that, especially in a changing environment.
You know, good point. Like, yes, just keeping at least the population surviving somehow, right?
Yes, that's what you want. Yeah.
So, from Ella, fascinating talk. Thank you, Leticia. When did you first come across worms, and why did you decide to pursue research on them? I'm going back from your master's or something, right?
Yes. Yeah. I mean, I kind of knew I cannot do work on mammals or mice, but then I did my master my first year of master in Chicago in the lab that actually my PI there, he discovered one of the major chaperones in the 70s. So it's a lab that studies stress, and I knew there were I was curious about the worms, and I have to say when I saw them, you know, under the microscope, they had this model of fluorescent worms where you see these tiny worms, and it had it was a model of aggregation. So it had this fluorescent protein in the muscle, and if the worms was fine, you would see all the outline fine. And then it's a model of Huntington disease. If they were stressed, you would see the aggregates in the muscle, and it was just so pretty. You know, I was very, I fell in love with it. Yeah, and I was, I'm gonna never switch, you know. And I mean, I did 12 years to be fair. So now I want also maybe to see a little bit something else, but yeah.
That's great. So any other questions? Otherwise I may go for one. And then maybe free you, release you. But Oh, yes. Okay. So another question from Teresa. Are there any similarities between this remodeling of fat metabolism in C. elegans and humans? Could we use this research in humans in the future, perhaps?
A good question. And I really don't know. I have to say, yeah, it's kind of different because they are ectotherms and we are endotherms. So the similarity in a way is that there is an input of the nervous system in all of that, and that we didn't know in worms. But then as to how, honestly, I cannot tell you yet how it could be applied to humans, because obviously it's very different, the metabolism. But I know I've tried to say a lot, you know, that a lot of things are conserved, but sorry, I cannot say yet. But I guess what I can say with that, you know, is like the worm is such a great tool that it's a little bit like playing with Legos, you know. You want to, because it's so complex, because it's such a fundamental mechanism that it's so complex, and there are really a lot of unanswered questions, you know. What is going on exactly in the membrane? How do they sense, you know, how is this signaling? We really haven't everything figured out, and it's possible that some part of what we will find about this, you know, also some elements of it might be conserved in humans, but then you will need to do also a lot of work in humans to find that is also the case, obviously. But the worm is such a nice tool to try to dissect, you know, what's going on, and things like this that we cannot do in humans. So it's a very great tool to explore.
Yeah, I guess that's sort of the signaling path that are so complex, even in worms, I guess in humans, we still need to find out all of the past metabolism path that we have, right? Because actually I had a question similar to that, in that line, like the theory that you were mentioning about homeoviscous adaptation. Mm-hmm. So I guess in other organisms like bacteria you mentioned, right? I guess that happens, or that happens just like in the individual kind of cell. Like it's triggered by just transcription factor
I'm not
producing.
I forgot all the details, but I know there are receptors also within the membrane that sense, you know, the deformation of the membranes also.
And that's what triggers
the
reaction in the individual cell.
And I think it's known also, that part we know a little bit in the worm. We have a receptor that is conserved also in worms, which is called adiponectin receptors. And that is able to sense some changes in the membrane. But how this, the whole picture of, you know, how this is exactly connected, we don't completely know yet. And especially the part for coming from the neurons. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I mean, it's a really fundamental mechanism, because it's a bit like the stress response. You really need this to survive. So it's kind of complex also, all the regulation of it. It's like the more you explore, it's like, you know,
there are too many things there to try and pin down and find out what every individual link do. Yeah, no, I guess. Great. So any last minute questions? Otherwise, it's almost 7. So I think we should thank you and wish you all the luck in the next stage. And again, you'll keep us posted in the next
of
month.
Of course, I'll be in touch. Yeah. And thanks a lot.
So thank you, everyone. And we hope to see you in the next Life for Lucy. Bye for now.
Bye.